And now here's Pastor Ruby Cottle from God's Faithful Disciples and the Prayer Clinic. You may call her at 323-293-7566. Her website is gfdjc.org. Leave your prayer requests or praise report. Her email is gfdjc@att.net or write Pastor Cottle at P.O. Box 561-368, Los Angeles, California, 90056. Remember, if you need prayer, call 323-293-7566.
Amen, amen.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Oh, my God, we are in the ninth month. Can you imagine? God, you are so awesome. God, you are so great. God, you are so magnificent and you are so glorious. Thank you, Father God, for this opportunity to speak into the lives of those that belong to you. Hallelujah. Good afternoon, saints. Good morning, saints, wherever you are in the planet. I just want to greet you in the name of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, my Lord. Hopefully, if he's not your Lord as yet, he will become your Lord. Glory be to God. And I just want to pray before I get into my message. I love to pray before I get into my message. Amen. So if you're somewhere where you can bow your heads, just lean down and listen and agree with me in prayer. Father, I thank you and I praise you today in the mighty name of Jesus. I come, oh God, before your throne. You said, come boldly, but I come humble right now, God. And I ask you that you would breathe upon each person under the sound of my voice, oh God, that they will hear, receive, understand what they hear today through your Spirit. As he speaks through me, I ask you, Father, that you would breathe upon me. Hallelujah. Holy Spirit, I decrease right now that you may increase. And because you have given me power to trample on scorpions, I walk in that authority right now. Bind up principalities and powers, rulers of the spiritual wickedness in high places. I command them to go back to their sender in the name of Jesus. I sprinkle the blood right now over the airwaves. Hallelujah. So that everything that is spoken by the Spirit of God can comfort. Oh God, anoint your people's ears and open their hearts that they may receive, that they may understand, that they may retain and apply what they hear in the mighty name, the name that is above every name, the name that every knee will confess and every tongue will speak that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of the Father. Amen. Hallelujah. And again, people of God, the name of my message is called When the Church Prays. Hallelujah. In Christ, hallelujah. When the church prays, amen. And I believe that there are people who are waiting on God to do some things for them. Well, I'm here to remind you, God will not do for you those things he has granted you the dominion and the capability to do for yourself. God will only do for you what you cannot do for yourself. If you are a born-again believer, if you are a child of God, according to Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 3, and I need you to go there with me, I want you to see what God has given you when you became born again. You see, a lot of people are waiting on God, and God is saying, and I'm waiting on you. Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 3 says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ. If you're not in Christ, these blessings are not for you, because Jesus Christ came and paid the penalty for your sins and mine, so that when you accept him and allow him to become your Lord and Savior, when you have accepted him and placed your faith and trust in him, in Christ Jesus, the anointed one, the Son of the living God, then and only then, this blessing is for you. It says again, I'm going to read that because you have read it and maybe you have forgotten what it says. It says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Again, if you have not given your life to Christ, and maybe you will by the time I finish preaching this message, you will be able to receive these blessings. Amen. And so don't forget, I said it and I will repeat myself, and you will hear me repeating this back and forth. And sometimes people tell me that I am very repetitive, and I do this on purpose. Why? Because sometimes people listen, but they don't grasp it at the first time. But when they hear it the second and the third time, then they grasp it. And I'm here to bring a word to you today to help you to get into a place where you can understand. Because if you are not a part of a church, if you're not a part of a group of people that are praying, then you are missing the mark. If you're not a part of a group of believers, you see, the Bible says the church, we are the church. But we, when we pray by ourselves, that's a wonderful thing. But when you pray with a bunch of believers, it makes a difference. And I'm going to prove to you what I'm saying. Don't forget, God will not do for you those things He has granted you the dominion and the capability to do for yourself. Go with me to the book of Acts chapter 12. Acts chapter 12. Glory be to God. And I hope you have your Bible. And I'm going to start to read at verse 5. I'm talking today about Peter. And there is a, let me give you a little setup on this. They had arrested these disciples, okay? And they had killed James, the Lord's brother, and they put Peter in prison. Glory be to God. Let me tell you something. I need to back up for a minute because I want you to hear me today. I am speaking to people that are in spiritual prisons today. There is a bunch of believers. I'm not talking to the people in the world. I am talking today to believers, sons and daughters of God, that are in spiritual prisons. Well, or you may be in a different kind of prison. I'm going to get there in a minute. But I want you to see, because Peter couldn't do this for himself, God sent him help. Go with me to Acts chapter 12 and verse 5. The Bible says, Peter was therefore kept in prison, but constant prayer was offered to God for him by the church. Constant prayer was offered to God for Peter by the church. And when Herod was about to bring him out, that night, Peter was sleeping bound with two chains between two soldiers, and the guards before the door were keeping the prison. Now behold, an angel of the Lord stood by him, and a light shone in the prison, and he struck Peter on the side and raised him up, saying, "Arise quickly," and his chains fell off his hands. I need to stop there. People of God, Peter could not release himself from this prison. He was bound up with chains. He had he was bound up not only with chains, but he was bound to these soldiers. When you are in a place where you can't help yourself and you are a believer and the church is praying for you, guess what? God is going to send you help. Now, the flip side of that is this. Some of us are in situations where we can do some things for ourselves, but we are waiting on God to send help. And God has already given you the power and the capability to do some things for yourself. Glory be to God. And so here it shows you, and I need to read that again. It says, so when he had arrested him, Peter, he put him in prison and delivered him to four squadrons of soldiers to keep him, intended to bring him before the people after the Passover. That was verse 4. What happened here is he was going to bring Peter out before the Passover and show him and then try to kill him like he'd already killed James, the Lord's brother. Glory be to God. But the Bible said, Peter was therefore kept in prison, but constant prayer. When the church prays, if the church do not pray, then nothing will happen. Who are the church? The church are you and I. God has called me today to sound an alarm. And I know that there are people out there listening, because I've been observing that there's different churches now that are calling prayer meetings. And I just pray that the people that are coming to these prayer meetings are beginning to fast. I'm going to bring a message to you next week about that. But what I'm trying to say to you is that God has called me to sound an alarm. Why? Because the church had been has not been praying. The church has been lackadaisical. The church has been living like the Laodicean church in Revelation chapter 3. And God has called me, and I'm sounding an alarm. Glory be to God. And if you, my sister, my brother, are in a church and your church is not having prayer meetings, then you need to sound the alarm and bring it to your pastor's remembrance and let him know that, you know, and I don't care if you don't start off with two or three people. Bible say one can chase 1,000 and two can chase 10,000. And so I'm here today to sound an alarm, because the church has to take back dominion. The church has to take back dominion over your neighborhood. The church has to take back dominion over your region, over your community. There's a lot of churches in neighborhood, and there's so much killing and shooting going on. And how can there be a church? But you see, if the church has no power, glory be to God, then the demons are going to walk in. You got to understand, how do you think that boy went into that church back east somewhere and shoot all those people? They were at a Bible study. But listen to me, people of God. Where there's prayer, there is power. And where there's constant prayer, there is power. Where there's prayer, where you speak in tongues, praying in the Holy Ghost, there is power. There is power in two or three, according to Matthew chapter 18, verse 19 and 20. The Bible says, where two touch and agree. Glory be to God. But today, I'm here to sound the alarm. You see, Peter was locked up. Peter could not unchain himself. Why? He had soldiers that he was guarded to. He was chained up with chains, real chains. What are you chained up in, my friend? What is holding you bound? What are you bound in? There's people right now that are in spiritual prison. Some people are bound up because they are in wrong marriages. Some people have mental problems. Some people, they need to be delivered from drugs. Some people need to be delivered from demonic oppression. Some people need to be delivered from anger, from strife. Some people need to be delivered from confusion. Some people need to be delivered from judgmental spirit. Some people need to be delivered from all kinds of things. And then you have those that are literally in a physical prison. They're behind bars. Some of them have more freedom than people that are outside in the everyday life. But here, I'm here to tell you that when you cannot help yourself, God can help you and deliver you from everything that you are going through. Some of you have been, and I said this last week, and it's necessary to repeat it. Some of you have been trying to find a job. I told a woman just this morning, she was telling me, she said, I'm going to the doctor and I'm going to get my eyes done. And I said, you need to pray before the doctor touches you. You need to sit in your car and take authority over that demon of unbelief. And when you sit in your car and you bind up all the demonic forces, because you don't want people touching you unless they may not know God, but when you pray, glory be to God. You see, Proverbs chapter 3, 5 and 6 says, we must trust in the Lord in all our heart and not to lean to our own understanding. And if all our ways we acknowledge him, he will direct our path. You don't go nowhere and let no doctor put their hands on you, glory be to God, without praying first. We are children of the Most High God. We got to include God in everything that we do. So my brother, you have been out there trying to find a job, but you have forgotten that there is a God. There is a God that owned the cattle with 1,000 hills that can help you, but you forgot. You've been sending out applications and you've been putting out resume, but you have not called on the name of the Lord yet and ask him to tell you, give you favor. Lord, I'm a child of yours. Lord, you own the cattle with 1,000 hills. Lord, remove the unbeliever application and put mine. Give me favor. Give me favor, God. You said, oh God, that this book of the law shall not depart from my mouth, and I shall dedicate in it. If I put myself in it, I'm talking about Joshua chapter 1 and 8. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it, and then you will make your way prosperous and you will have good success. Have you spoke to God this morning before you went out there to look for that job? Have you spoke to God last night and tell him to give you favor with the boss? Have you asked God and remind him that he says, if I give, it shall be given back to me, pressed down, shaken together, running over, shall men put in my bosom? Have you reminded God that he is the one that gives seed to the sower? And if you have a, make a vow to God. Now, I know people don't like to do this. And say, Lord, when I get my first job, I promise you, I'm going to start tithing. I have not been tithing. And I repent, because you can't catch up on no tide, but you can repent and start over. My brother, my sister, I'm just here to remind you that God is able to bring you out of that situation that you are in. If it's drugs that's holding you bound, God can deliver you and set you free. With God, all things are possible. My brother, my sister, you do not have to be in that place. No, your finances don't have to be raggedy, but you need to call out upon this God and ask him for help. Don't go out there by yourself. The Bible says when the enemy comes in like a flood, God will lift up a standard against him. God is waiting for you to call upon him. Not only for salvation, you've already been saved, but now you need prosperity. Now you need a deeper walk with God. Now you need for God to show you which way to go. The Bible said to let the word of God to be a lamp to your feet and a light to your path. The Bible says to let hide the word of God in your heart that you may not sin against him. Well, you may not be sinning, but you are not calling upon the Lord. I read a scripture this morning about Jehoshaphat, and they were coming after him. They were coming after him all around him. And the Bible says, Jehoshaphat called out upon the name of the Lord. Glory be to God. It's in just in 2 Chronicles chapter 20. And the Bible says that the man of God, the prophet, came and told Jehoshaphat, because you have called upon the name of the Lord, I will help you. I don't know who I'm talking to today, but I want to remind you that God is able to bring you out of your lackadaisical situation. God is able to bring you out of your poverty mentality. God is able to change your whole situation. God can give you a job. God can give you a business. God can bring you into another place if you remind him that he is your God and that you need his help. You see, people, the Bible says that whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. But let me tell you something. Salvation came with five things. Salvation came with perseverance. Salvation came with safety. Salvation came with soundness of mind. Salvation came with healing. And salvation came with deliverance. So what am I saying to you? I'm saying to you, don't just look at your salvation and only focus on the fact that I'm going to heaven. God wants you here, and God does not want you in a place. I don't preach prosperity message, but I'm trying to get somebody to understand that we have a God that owns the cattle with 1,000 hills, and all the gold and all the silver belongs to him, and he has no need of it. So what am I saying to you? If you call upon the name of the Lord, if you allow him to be a part of your everyday life, you will get what it is that you need. Oh, some of you may have a child and the child is sick. You have no money to pay the doctor. Don't you know that God can bring you into favor where they can wipe out that bill just like that? God, you got to stop limiting this God that we serve. If he was able to open up the Red Sea, my God, where the children of Israel was able to cross over on dry land, and then he turned around again and he opened up the Jordan River, glory be to God, and they walked over again on dry land. Don't you think that your little meager situation that you're going to, that he's able? But see, he's not going to do nothing unless you reach out to him. When you reach out to God, like the woman with the issue of blood, you know, I'm going way off my message, but I'm talking to somebody today. God always knows who need to hear what. I brought a certain message for you, but God knows what you need to hear today. Because I read where the woman with the issue of blood, she sat by the wayside and she heard about this Jesus who opens blind eyes, who let the lame walk, okay, who he opened up deaf ears, who raised people from the dead. And she said to herself, if I can only touch the hem of his garment, I will be made whole. I want you to know she didn't go to her friend and say that. She didn't go to her neighbor and say that. She didn't go to her children and say that. If she had a husband, she didn't tell him nothing. She said to herself, what am I saying to you, my brother, my sister? I'm saying, get in your closet. Reach out to God. He's able to deliver you. He's able to set you free. If you're bound up, he is able to set you free from all of your dilemmas. Everything. He can wipe out all your bad debts. Oh, yes, that's the God I'm talking about. All those credit cards that you're not able to pay. He can wipe out those debts. He can wipe off. Because I was praying Friday night, and I remember the Lord was... We were talking about praying for people with jobs that needs jobs. And the Holy Spirit reminded me. The Holy Spirit says, okay, you're praying for them to get jobs, but now you gotta pray for them because when they get the job and they check their credit report and they have a bad credit, they still won't get the job. So I said, Lord, I pray and I ask you in Jesus' name to clean up that person's credit report so that when they get the job, they will get the job. The job will be theirs. Because you see, the enemy puts all kinds of things in our way as a hindrance. But God has given you the power. God says in Luke chapter 10 and verse 19, I must go here. Look what God says, Luke 10 and 19. He says, behold, I give you authority to trample on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. What does that mean? If God has given you that kind of power, then you need to walk into that kind of authority. Don't walk around like limp-wristed Christians. No, you got to walk like your daddy is the king of the universe. Your daddy lives on the outside. The Bible says as many as accepted Jesus, he gave them the right to become sons of God. And so if you're a son of God, then guess what? Your daddy owns everything. And I'm here to remind you of that. So God is waiting for you to call upon him and ask him, to help you to jump over that mountain. God is waiting for you to call upon him and to ask him to remove the mountain so that you can cast that mountain into the sea. As I said, I am not preaching the message that I brought here today, but that's okay. God has somebody that needed to hear this. Hallelujah. Most of God's people are walking in a state of mind. They were never in a church where they ever experienced the move of the Holy Ghost. If you're in a dead church, then get out. I remember this lady told me one time, she said, I've been going to this church for 40 years. We don't even raise our hands no more. And I said, what are you doing there? Well, you know, my mother went there, and I said, who cares about what your mother did? If she made it to heaven, she's already in heaven. What are you doing for yourself? How are you bringing glory to God? How can you go to a church because a family member went there and you don't even raise your hands to give God glory? No. So you have never really experienced the presence of God. You don't know. I spoke to another woman that used to come to the prayer clinic, and she cried throughout the whole worship. She goes to Calvary Chapel Church, she said. She's never experienced the presence of God. If you're in a church where you have not experienced the presence of God, you're in the wrong place, because it means that the Holy Spirit is not moving. The Holy Spirit is not the head of that church. And any church that is being ran without the Spirit of the living God is not the church of God. Amen. And so today I want to encourage you. I'm here to tell you that you can be delivered from all of your problems. You can be set free from anything that is ailing you, anything that is causing you not to function in the fullness and the wholeness of your salvation. Glory be to God. Peter had some big problems. Was he in problems? He was bound up, the scripture said. He was bound up with chains. But I want you to notice the moment God sent the angel. And why did God send the angel? Because Peter could not loose himself from those chains. Peter could not deliver himself. He had to depend on God. And the church was praying. The Bible says the church was praying. Watch this. Now, constant prayer was offered to God for him by the church. If you are not in a church where they pray all the time, you know you're in a church that's powerless. Again, I'm going to repeat myself again like last week. Where there's no prayer, there's no power. Even for you, if you don't have a prayer life, I don't know why, but God has been giving me all these messages about prayer. But I believe God is trying to bring back people into having a relationship with Him. If you are not having a relationship, you cannot say you're having a relationship with Jesus Christ and the Father if you are not praying constantly. No prayer, no power. No prayer, no power. More prayer, more power. Glory be to God. So what am I saying today? Philippians chapter 1 and verse 29 gives me the ability to suffer for Christ, but also has given me the ability to overcome my problems. It's not what you go through, it's how you go through. Remember, we have weapons to go through the fight. What is your problem today? I would like to pray with you. If you would call me, I would love to pray with you at 323-293-7566. And why? Because Matthew chapter 18 and verse 19 and 20 says that when two come in agreement, and when you call me and I begin to pray with you, sometimes I ask people that they got to repent first. So if you're coming and calling me and you're puffed up, don't call me. But if you come humble, I can agree with you in prayer because again, I got to repeat this again. Peter was in prison and he decided to go to sleep. But guess what? He knew that there was folks out there praying for him. Who are you connected to today? Do you have a pastor that brings your name before the throne of grace every day? Do you have a prayer warrior that is a partner with you in prayer? Again, people do not understand. But what are spiritual blessings? I'm just about through. I want to encourage you. Spiritual blessings. In closing, listen to this. In closing, all the spiritual blessings that you are going to receive, they are only receptive if you are in Christ. If you are not in Christ, you will not receive them. And so today, I want you to know that God delivers perfectly, fully, everything we need. God has never done anything halfway. He never done a halfway job. All through the Bible, there is this trail of distinctive evidence. God does what He says, delivers what He promises, establishes sufficiency and power, and supply everything that you and I need. I want to remind you of that. So, what am I saying? The word in is a proposition. When you talk about in Christ, you're talking about a physical location. The physical location is in Christ. You have to place your faith and trust in Jesus Christ. I'd like to pray with you right now. Say, Father, I don't know Jesus as my Lord and Savior. Jesus, I heard that you died and you rose from the dead, and I believe it. I wasn't there, but I believe it. Right now, I place my faith and trust in you. I ask you to come and live into my life. Come in and live in my heart. Lord Jesus, I repent of my sins. I renounce all my satanic activities. I give you my life and I will live for you as you show me how. I thank you, Father, for giving your precious Son, Jesus Christ. I thank you for the shed blood that you shed on Calvary. So, Jesus, today I ask you to be my Lord and Savior, and I will be yours forever. I ask this in Jesus' name. thank you for my salvation. So, in Christ, chains can be removed. In Christ, you can come out of all your spiritual prison. In Christ, you can come out of your spiritual warfare. Not to say it's not going to happen again, because the devil never leaves you alone. He only left Jesus alone until an opportune time, but he came back. So today, in Christ, when you place your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, you will be saved. I'm inviting you to the prayer clinic. We're 8501 South Vermont, every Friday at 7 o'clock in Los Angeles, California. Our phone number is 323-293-7566. Again, we're at 8501 South Vermont at 7 o'clock, and that's in the city of Los Angeles, California, every Friday, right on that corner. Come and pray with us. Come and learn how to stand in the gap for your family member, for your pastor, for your church, for your neighborhood, for your community. God bless you. And we love you. I love you today with the love of the Lord. I hope to hear from you soon. 323-293-7566. God bless you until we meet again. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. I feel.